Great. Hello, everyone. Welcome. This is our 2022 SUTD Master of Architecture Sustainable Design Lecture Series. I'm Peter Ortner. I'm the coordinator for the Master of Architecture program. I'm also assistant professor for Architecture and Sustainable Design at SUTD. I'd like to welcome our audience, our Master of Architecture students, our undergraduates, distinguished alumni, our colleagues from the architecture field throughout Singapore, and students from outside SUTD, including from JCs and Polys. The Master of Architecture lecture series is meant to emphasize the centrality of sustainability in our SUTD program. We have been around for about 12 years now, and throughout that time, we've sought to position ourselves at the forefront of discourse on sustainable architecture, and especially with the Master of Architecture program, which deals with advanced topics in the design of architecture and sustainability. Over the past 12 years, we've had a number of historic firsts. For example, on this slide, we're showing the world's tallest 3D printed biomaterial tower by Stylianos Stritsas. One of the world's first fully functional space frame structures made of 3D printed stainless steel components, the air mesh by our professor Carlos Bañón. Additionally, in 2022, this year, we created the Master of Architecture Labs. This is a new feature of our curriculum, a new way of learning that brings together our faculty and Master of Architecture students to work on urgent challenges facing our built environment. We use the Master of Architecture thesis as a platform to create new knowledge and launch transformational careers for our students. This year we have 5 labs: the Circular Cities Lab, led by myself and Carlos Bañón; Future Health Lab, led by Christine Yogyaman, Jung Kai, and Jason Lim; Regenerative Assemblies, led by Ken Tracy and Michael Budick; Thomas Schroepfer's Future Cities Group; and Eva Castro's Inhabiting New Futures, Oceanic Environments and New Habitats. Today, I'll be inviting students from these labs, specifically students who are tackling waste, sustainable construction materials, to participate in the Q&A session after the lecture. Of course, we invite all audience members to participate in the Q&A as well. So the Master of Architecture lecture series permits us to invite distinguished architects from around the world, people who have made significant contributions to sustainable design. We bring them here to share their work and speak with our students. Typically at the end of the year, we invite these speakers back to chair the prize juries for our Master of Architecture end of year exhibition. So Arthur, if you're free in December, we'll be very keen to host you again if it's possible. Today's lecture is the second in this season's series. The overall theme this year is Design Beyond Zero, and I'd like to note that this title is inspired in large part by our speaker today, our guest, Arthur Huang, the founder and CEO of Miniwiz, and I will introduce him formally in just one moment. While the theme of Design Beyond Zero is intended to focus our attention on pressing challenges of zero carbon and zero waste architecture, we also hope to push towards maximization at the same time as we minimize, maximization of vibrancy, productivity, livability in our built environment. So with that, I'm very honored to share the virtual stage today with our distinguished guest, Arthur Huang. He's the founder and CEO of Miniwiz. Arthur combines expertise in both the field of architecture and engineering with an amazing entrepreneurial spirit and a very distinctive design style. Arthur trained as both an engineer and architect at Cornell and Harvard, and has gone on to be internationally renowned as a leader for design and circular economy, in the creation of zero waste products and buildings. He's been recognized by the World Economic Forum as a technology pioneer leading the circular economy revolution, engaged not only with design, but also with innovation for new materials and fabrication processes. Arthur has been granted 4 international patents for his technologies, which make decentralized upcycling a reality. I've even read that Miniwiz has a library of over 12,000 new materials and products they've created, from recycled cigarette butts, plastic bottles, old clothes, and other upcycled materials. Miniwiz, Arthur's company, spans between architecture and diverse fields of product design, material science, and robotics. They're based in Taipei, but Miniwiz has a global footprint, having completed over 300,000 square meters of circular development projects across 17 major global cities. They've created numerous award-winning projects, transforming local trash into modular upcycled building products with real estate developers and consumer brands like Nike, Starbucks, PMI, BAT, and McDonald's. A very small sampling of the awards won by Arthur and Miniwiz include the IDEAT Vision Award 2019, Obama Foundation Emerging Leader Award 2019, Vatican Award for Science, Ecology, and Architecture 2019, National Geographic Emerging Explorer Award 2016, IDEA Gold Award 2013, Bloomberg New York City Venture Fellow Award 2012, Wall Street Journal Innovation Award 2012, and the Financial Times Earth Award in 2010. We're also very lucky that Arthur and Miniwiz have taken on growing engagements in Singapore with recent visits for collaboration and exhibitions, including at our National Design Center. So with this lecture, we're hopeful that we can encourage more interaction, collaboration with Arthur and his team, here at SUTD in particular, and that we can work together towards a zero waste circular economy. So Arthur, thank you so much for taking the time to be with us today. With this, I will stop sharing my screen and I'll invite you to take over.
Okay, hello everyone. My name's Arthur. Thank you, Peter, for the generous introductions. I hate the introduction anyways. So let's get to the point. Okay. So first of all, let me just share my screens and this. Okay, so I truncated the presentation to specifically kind of give you a glimpse of what we are doing. Okay, and then later I will just take my, I'll keep this within 20 minutes, and then I will take my notebook and I'm actually sitting at our little like fab and factory, so you can kind of have a like a virtual tour, like what we are doing, how we do it. I think it's interesting to see how a real company can actually do 10 to 20 to $30 million of business a year, just using these simple tools. Okay, so should be a hopeful lecture, even though we are faced with lots of crap. Here you go. So this is a 2-minute video just to summarize why we want to matter.
We want to matter. We want to matter to the non-toxic future of our world. We want to matter to the sustainability of our community. At Miniwiz, it is our mission to change consumer behavior into a circular one. It is the only way for us as a species to sustainably consume our limited resources. Overconsumption is a complex system problem. There is no single miracle cure. We want to matter by proving human consumption can be satiated with our very own trash. We have dedicated ourselves to turning decades of environmental pollution into solutions that will enable us to live sustainably. We want to matter, so we turn ourselves into magicians of trash, inventing new ways of transforming our everyday trash into high-performance works of art. We turn milk packaging into the hottest sportswear fashion, plastic bottles into luxurious textile, cigarette butts into furnitures and glasses,
using fashion and apparel waste into luxurious home furnishings, mask PPE into cell phone chargers, single-use medical waste material into hospitals, using smart AI technology to make decentralized recycling upcycling possible today.
We head to Taiwan for this report, and a company designing solutions to overcome a mounting problem of a mountain of trash. From furniture to hospital wards, all built from waste, one CEO is on a mission to revolutionize recycling.
His team has used waste to develop over 1,200 different materials for use in construction. The company turning different kinds of waste, like plastic bottles, into materials for buildings and products across the world.
We want to matter, but unfortunately we are out of time. Please join us in upcycling today's local pollution into circular ESG building solutions of the future.
Okay, it sounded like there's, yeah, join us, easy to say, hard to do. Okay, so first of all, let me entice you to join us. First of all, if you think in the future 50 years, climate crisis is not an issue, then you should do something else. I think that is one of the most important issues that will face humanity and in all of us, universal. Okay, that's, I think we can get that out of the way. But what's interesting is it is also a $556 billion a year business. That's more than automobile business, by the way. Okay. And green building market is prime for revolution. Why do I say that? It's because it hasn't really been as much innovation for the last 100 years, 120 years. Since glass and steel and concrete are massively used in our construction, okay? It hasn't changed. And I love the approach that SUTD is taking, and I hope that can give you a sense that it is a huge business opportunity too. And there's not many people invested in this. That's okay. So if you don't hear those words as interesting, okay, I don't know. Okay, the next thing is, how do you make the most impact for climate change? And surprisingly, 38% global carbon footprint is generated by buildings, architecture. People don't talk about it, but it's actually there. It is the number. And the 23% of waste are generated by building alone. And 40% of water pollution is also generated by building. So just imagine, we actually did a very quick calculation, just focus on the fit-out market. You guys know what the fit-out market is? It's just interior deco, ceilings, walls, and floors. Not furniture, by the way, not furniture, interior. It is already a $64 billion a year in Southeast Asia, Middle East, and EU alone, okay? Every year, per year. This is a market big enough for all of you guys to do the exact same thing that we are doing. So I just want to encourage you to do that. But the next thing is, we've been around for 20 years, but within the last 20 years, one of the biggest problems, we don't have any tailwind. For a long time, most of our, there's no demand for building made from trash. There's no demand that's for low carbon products, no demand. So recently, in all within this year, by the way, USA, the SEC, do you guys know what SEC is? Security Exchange Commission, basically control all the listed stock traded company in the world and US, okay? So they require mandatory and operational carbon footprint disclosure for all listed company in 2023. First of all, then now you have to know what is a carbon footprint. If you ask any architecture firm today, I'm pretty much 100% or 99% sure that nobody can give a carbon footprint analysis of their building activities. I'll show you later. You have to do that in the very near future. All of us has to do that. The second is obviously from my local where we started from Taiwan government. We recently won two major public tender. And the reason why we can win these giant tenders from government is because they require a green building certification for all public tender with 10% green product and with minimum of 20% recycled content. imagine Singapore government also has that rule for all public tender. Yeah, just imagine the business opportunity there. For Singapore, obviously you guys have a green plan, zero waste plan. It's targeting the building sector to lead the decarbonization effort. So everybody knows the data, building is coming online as one of the way to be the major force in climate change reduction solutions. And the last one is probably the most morally superior group of people, the EU government's Green Deal. It's called, they want to, they have 8 pillars, I remember correctly. And the 8 pillar, the number one pillar is efficient building renovation, means that's a way to reduce carbon reductions and also create jobs. Okay, so by the way, all the picture you see are generated by Miniwiz, mostly are built project. I hate showing non-built projects. So just give you a sense that trash into cash, this is kind of the key word, because we used to keep trying to preach and teach people or ask people to be sustainable. Please, you cannot do this in a moral way. You have to entice people in a financial way. Okay, so we also have to make our services very financially sustainable and simple. Simple, simple, simple is the key. The three things we do, one is LCS specification software. It's able to embed into architecture firm, engineering firms, and to give them live LCA data. So while you're designing, you know what is the carbon footprint, what's the damage that you're doing to the environment. And modular building system, that's the second one. So when you have a specification into a, let's say, a real estate development lifecycle, you need to have a, people say, oh, show me the stuff. You need to put a market price product, a market comparable product on par with the market price. You have to be able to deliver that system to show that the system is faster, better, higher performance, especially during post-pandemic. It's all about antibacterial, antiviral. And on top of that, you have to be lower labor force to build these systems. So that's why we have these products already developed and ready to deploy. And the third is upcycling machineries, because this is where we want to spend a lot more effort working with engineering students, designers, to be able to use these background IP. We call these upcycling machines and system kitchens. So once you have a kitchen, you have a basic cookbook, you know what type of food, what type of nutrients you're creating for your customer, for the environment, then you need to enable them with that kitchen. We talk about low temperature cooking, right? Have you guys heard of that? In all the Michelin 3-star restaurant, they're trying to cook all the, it's to preserve nutrients, yeah? Low temperature cooking, it's make you healthier. It's supposed to, this require a low temperature cooking machine, right? So you need to combine vacuum, you need to combine pressure, you also need to combine a temperature. But at low, what's a medium to transfer that temperature onto a piece of meat, for example? That's the type of machine that's required, and that's simple to use. So basically, this is the three things that we do. Okay, so, and this is the picture here is a museum we built in Taiwan with 1.5 million PET bottles with this proprietary machineries. You can see it's modular, no glue. Everything is self-reinforcing each other. We call it self-structuring system. And even the steel frame is actually made from the, you know, highway formwork. That's why it's all super short. It's like cut into this 2.2 meters, and it's all modular from the, yeah, we have to design a weird joint to combine these all steel structure together. Yeah. So that is the EcoArt in Taipei. And so the revolution, I think, I don't know if you guys seen Fight Club. When I was starting the company, there's this movie that's very, really touches my heart. It's called Fight Club. I'm sure the professor, Peter's laughing, obviously probably my age, but I think I don't know, I can see other people's faces, but probably not, but please go watch it. I love it. Edward Norton's and Brad Pitt. And there's another movie that also come out. It's, Fight Club is about having a series of decentralized Fight Club, right? So we need a series of decentralized zero waste Fight Club. So we can gather this grassroots power to influence the status quo, or destroy the status quo, if you call that. I'm sure Singapore government will hate me with this, but good thing I'm invested by the government too. So Singapore government. So these are just looking at the picture, don't read the text. These are like typical just information from financial side of a company. But this is, if you go across Italy, when you guys are going on vacation, you guys can go on vacation these days. If you guys are travel or studies in Europe, in Italy, in Rome, Milan, Torino, Firenze, Madonna di Campidio, when you go skiing. But anyway, there's a lot of these stores. They're all made from cigarette butts, turned into air filter with Philip Morris, okay? And they're all, you can see, they're all like this weird modular self-interlocking structure that has lights, air filters, speakers all integrated into one brick. So it's a giant Lego block that kind of connects into this weird terrace system. This is a Nike headquarter in New York and Portland and Tokyo. They're all built from fashion waste and turning into these insulation panels. And every room is different. It's about mass customization of every room with the same material. Yeah. And you can see there's not much decor, ceiling and wall and furniture. That's it. So, and the Nike stores, Nike Lab around the world, if you go to New York, Paris, London, you will see Tokyo, Hong Kong, you will see these stores. Unfortunately, Singapore didn't have one yet, but they are all made from Nike waste, from their productions or directly from post-consumer, from all shoes to all the rack, everything that's hanging from the ceiling, they're all made from trash. And I will explain that more later. So in general, this is what we do as a summary, okay, of all that you just heard. We take sorted waste, basically B2B and B2C, okay? This includes what you drink from plastic to textile, mixed textile, all the way to aluminium, glass, okay? And these are the basic material we take from a consumer. We go into our engine, that's what we call it. But this design engine is like started with D, material data. I think people can get that. Without material data, the four data you need, you cannot do simulation. So you do not know where any of that material can go into, get into. So you need mechanical, modulus, tensile, and impact. Okay, so without those data, your computer is ridiculously dumb, basically. They can't do anything. But so we've been collecting lots of this data from all kinds of consumer waste. However, you're limited by gravity, yeah? Your gravity is limited by the production technology, okay? So the technology, for example, 3D printing, the spool or any type of powder you want to go to sintering, that's limited by the technology, right? How hot the plasma is, right? It's all limited by the machine. So different type of manufacturing method. So the data will be further trickled down by limitation of different use of different manufacturing technology and machines. The last thing, how we can actually make this thing really exponentially growth with lots of potential is through this specification simulation and LCA software. Okay, I will explain that later, but this is localized specification, but unfortunately the whole world is similar because fire in Singapore behave still quite similar to fire in Scotland. And water seepage are still very similar. You might have temperature difference, but the water still move the same way. Gravity still move the same way. So the building standard has some sort of very universally linked. Okay, so this is what we mean by what we call scalable engine, yeah? Okay, and then the C is where it's not scalable because that is localized connections with creative communities. So for example, working in Singapore, you need architects to be on board. You need local waste collectors to be on board. They are very localized business. Yeah. So this is where we link up with any creative community locally to create this ESG value, whatever you call it, environment, social, and governance. But then, of course, in the meantime, this value needs to also be designed for second life and third life. Okay, so in reality, we're designing in a very strange way that we take away our hands or our traditional tools, and we're kind of building our new tools to be able to do that. But most importantly, it needs to be financial gain, even though a lot of people, especially my investor, hates me saying that, that I don't really care about the financial gain, but I need to show them I can do financial gain. But for me, what's most important is the equitable society as a personal thing. Yeah. Okay. So I hope the many of the technology we develop is equitable. So this engine that we are doing is not designed to be cornered by Miniwiz. It's designed to share, but except for a long time, nobody give a crap and no one want to learn what we know. Okay. So this is where SUTD and Miniwiz might potentially have a lot of fun. Yeah. Working on that. So I just want to zoom in on what we mean by infrastructure and that engine. So the physical manifestation of that engine is this, and we have this in Taipei, and that's why I'm going to show you what this thing is, okay? But this is what we put when we put it in a container. This is a project we did for COP27 or 26 in England, and this was supposed to be sponsored by Rothschild, which is the biggest behind the scene banking group, right? Okay, so this was supposed to be able to take any waste on the Thames, but this is, we have this in Taiwan, okay? And we are scaling this system in different way, okay? So this is what we mean, a physical manifestation of that. And we did a first test of this in 2016. We take this kind of this concept and we test it in the foothill of Himalayas, was still quite high, still like 4,500 meters in the Tibet Plateau, where the three river meets. Okay, the reason why we did that is because I received a letter with lots of pictures of lots of horrible cow eating modern plastic trash in the middle of plateau, and there's no recycling system in sight. Okay, so Jackie Chen and our team decided like maybe we can do a cool project to put everything we know for the last like 15 years at that time and into a portable manufacturing platform with no secondary pollution. I think I want to stress no secondary pollution. I mean, there's many levels of pollution. Having a battery is a pollution too, by the way. Making the solar panel, there is a relevant pollution too. I'm just saying, doing the operation, there's no secondary pollution, because normally the biggest problem with recycling is that if you want to do recycling, you need to clean the trash, you need to dry the trash, you need to compress the trash. It uses energy, uses water, uses air. Yeah. So this system is designed to have zero water footprint. Okay. Because the water is all reverse osmosis within the system. The energy is powered only by its solar and the battery, okay? And the backup system is also another battery, right? With biodiesel, okay? With a biodiesel generator that power the, so we were trying to do hydrogen, but it was too dangerous to ship on the road because we couldn't get road. Yeah. Anyway, so the energy, and then the air is all captured into solid state. So it create these like solid state, this is a very interesting experience. So you take trash from one end and you can come out into a tile. That's what's the systems. So this is our first, we now have three of this around the world, but only two of them, none of them is operational right now, actually, but they are only two of them is fully functioning, but not in operation. Okay, because it's too complicated. I just wanted to say, so complicated. Okay. It needs four engineers on site, you know, so you see the complexity of doing a project like this. So that's why you see Trash Brazil, a national design center. That is dumb. It's designed to be dumb. And I think being dumb is at the end is ultimately is actually one of a way to get people to understand this thing better. So we're scaling this in Middle East. I can tell you, cannot tell you which country yet, but you can tell that it start off with using the trash to make a net zero carbon footprint building using local waste. Okay. And then within that building, you put in the decentralized upcycling manufacturing site. Okay. And then on top of that, it became a learning and a center for workshops. And this is what we mean by Fight Club, where we like-minded people can come in here and disrupt the existing supply chain. Okay. So this is real projects. So hopefully you'll see this in Singapore soon. I seriously hope. Yeah. So this is a more complete version from the material. Everything here is already made from trash. I don't know if you can see the side. Yeah. And we're using local fillers, HDPE, to make these giant interlocking blocks. And they are become our reservoir for trash materials and for sand, and using seawaters as a thermal block. So this is quite fun. Okay, let me get to the LC analysis. What we mean by software. Everybody uses Rhino, everybody uses Grasshopper, everybody uses AutoCAD, everybody uses Rivet. Everybody uses all this different program. How does all this program link to sustainability? That's what we are doing. Okay. We have this, we get everything into modules, and all modules go through a LC analysis. Okay. Individually, very simple. And that LC analysis then link to environmental data. And so for example, Singapore EPA can publish their energy footprint data, transportation data, distant data, all that stuff. All that is inputted here, yeah? And then right away, in these 3D models, you can right away get this live. So as you are moving the object alone, or deleting certain thing, adding one extra layer, deleting a certain layer, things change. Your design change. Right away, you know, wall and ceiling, this is the individual version of our, this is a real project. So I want to show you, this is in National Taiwan University. We built two classrooms, one traditional way, one Miniwiz way. Okay. And we have two bankable data. Bankable means because you save carbon footprint, you actually get carbon credits too, by the way. Bankable data. So from wall, ceiling, flooring, total, and this is the individual of that wall and what are the footprints. So right away, you know how to make your design better on the component level. This is how you make it in the building spatial level. And this is comparing type. What type of buildings, okay? You see 0.7 here? That's one of the lowest type. That is a hut. A school in India is made from straw. That's the carbon footprint that's required, okay? So, and the pink you see here, that is a typical Singaporean building, by the way, interior. Plaza, A plaza means hotels and commercial spaces. Did you see this? This is very interesting. So you can compare in zone. All right, what type of buildings you're comparing to. So this is what we did in a very quick strike projects. We always like these quick strike pilot projects. So we just bring in the dumbest machine that we had, and we want to be able to use local creativity, working with Pomeroy, working with Salistop, its own staff and executive. They are actually the guy who is collecting the trash from the blue bin. And they are the one who's making the ceilings and wall tiles and the shelving system, all made from this machine. 2 weeks, okay? So I mean, if you think about it, you know, you have a community cleanup basically for 2 weeks, and then you turn it into your beautiful store. I think that is the right type of stories, what we want to show. This is a scale project of what the trash hub can do. This is a Hong Kong old airport turning to the biggest shopping mall in Hong Kong now. This is completing, it's designed by Stone Hedda. But you know, like Western, the famous Western like super firm, they basically are doing conceptual design, right? The local architects are actually doing the grunt of the work. Okay, but what's our role here? Our role is to work with the conceptual architects to come up with the right color. So this color, according to Stone Header, by the way, all this color, interior, all the walls are made with Miniwiz this. Yeah? Okay, this thing is fashion waste. And then turning into, and it's actually called a, they want to have a concept of copper oxidizing before it turns green. So they want that moment in time of that color, okay? So it requires so many different color to create that depth of this liver color, okay? And then they also want to have a weaving pattern to looks like a basket. So you can see the detail here, it has a weaving pattern. It also reinforces the, and by the way, this wallpaper, 3D wallpaper, it not only damper the sound, it has an NRC, you know, noise canceling quality. On top, it has an antibacterial quality, durability issues. It has to hit ASTM this, AMA this, it has to hit a British system that. Anyways, it, and then the worst is that the funny thing is the all the building performance side is easy compared to the conceptual performance. The conceptual performance, you need to have 8 colors of fashion waste to mix into that at that scale, at that volume, right? At 4,000 meters, square meters, right? So that's mean you have to get a certain type of control of that color. So then we have to design an AI machine, a camera, basically linked with a computer to make sure the input and the output can match in a very consistent manner. You see the innovation is not at the conceptual design. The architect can say, I want this copper oxidation tone, right? But the work to be done is on that part to get that color right, you see? So this is almost finishing. July will be done. Hopefully you guys can visit soon in Hong Kong. This is what we recently completed with the largest real estate developer in Taiwan and their corporate headquarter. We call it a baby stadium, okay? And this one is actually all made from building construction waste. Waste we collected from building construction site. Okay, so this is all the furniture here. It's made from cement bag. This is paper and LDPE, okay? By the way, most of our product has no binder, means we don't add additional thermoplastic or thermoset plastic. Okay, and then you see this, all the shelving system are all, and of course, wood. The wood here is not from building construction site. It's actually existing from their old building renovation. We took down the wood and we trim it to this. So at least, and we did not make the carpet, by the way. Carpet we bought from a company who is already made 70% from recycled content. And then they also are responsible for the take back. Okay, so pretty much like from the ceiling, walls, all the way to everything you see here is either made from recycled polyester, fashion waste, construction waste, and even has a quite a beautiful toilet that's actually made from all the leftover cement and tiles we collected on the construction site. It's a terrazzo, basically. Everybody knows that, but that's quite simple. And don't worry, guys, this is the last page, and then we can get down to some virtual tour. We used to do a lot of, have a lot of projects in different range of projects, from interior to campuses, which is like multiple buildings, from, and many of these projects you see are quite challenging financially and also technical, if you think about it, because you have to pass through different government regulations, right? On top, you have to work with different contractors locally. So all that lesson learned, we're combining that and we are starting to do becoming more like a real estate developer. Because in order for you to affect change is for you to actually control the building supply, right? What material to buy? That's a key. What material to buy? So at the end, we're doing, joint tendering with real estate developers and we build these infrastructure. And then we recently won lots of these major tenders in Taiwan. And then these major tenders creates a minimum requirement. We are talking about $80 million of material requirements for this type of work. So we are shifting our priorities to be the guy who wants to buy whatever you are coming out with. So yes, please focus your study on this. Thank you. And here, let me show you a little bit of our lab. This is not our office, but this is kind of where we do a lot of funny, dirty work. So let me get to, I want to stop sharing. Wait, how do you stop sharing? I think I stopped sharing, right? Oh, stop share. Okay, you guys can see me now, right? Going to move to, can you guys see? What do you guys see? We have a actual airplane sitting in our factory. That's my baby. And because we think basically all design should be like an airplane because it's agnostic to what you think is pretty or not, because the nature kind of dictates the performance of the aircraft, right? The design of the aircraft. And the material also dictates. So we had a series of R&D projects with the airplane wing project, we call it, and we use recycled material to replace the airplane wing of a real plane. And that plane is really something. It's Burt Rutan. Recently, he just put Richard Branson to space. Yeah, it's the same guy, okay? He's also the guy who invented lots of incredible aircraft. This is in the 1970s, and then it's all hand-drawn without computer simulation. So the first thing we did is we 3D scan that plane, okay? And we did a structural analysis of that plane on every, from the macro to the micro, yeah? The little joints. And then we developed material to implement onto the plane. Okay, and then you see CNC machine, different type of contraption we built with air power, laser cutters, very traditional stuff from trimming machines to bandsaw to table saw to welding machine. Okay, so, and yeah, I just want to quickly show you this. Can you guys see this? I don't know if you can see. This is a, I don't know if I could turn this on. Let me turn this back. Anyways, this is a machine and a set of machines we kind of put together. It's actually a material mixer, if you look at it like that. This is an extruder. So for example, if I want to make a spool made from trash to go into a 3D machine, I can do it right here. But in reality, this set of machine is for us to get material data. Okay, so you need this to be able to create lots of this material test strip. You guys see? And then material test strip can then go into to test all kinds of mechanical properties. Then it goes into computers, then you can link that to all your simulation software. Right. So this morning, we just take a bunch of mushroom and we just create some materials to, here's a material we created. And that is going into the injection machine. Yeah, and then make test strips. And then you test that, so you know the mechanical property of packaging with mushroom, and then you directly know what that property can be to go into your simulation software for mechanical strength or whatever application you want. All right, so I'm done. So hopefully you guys get a sense of what the hell is going on there. Yeah. And of course, I did not go underneath. Underneath has lots of like different sets of machines, different type of hydraulic control, smart hydraulic control presses, and like hydraulic casting machine. We don't like casting, but I mean, we still do have them. Yeah. So that's it.
Arthur, thank you so much. It's really cool to take the tour of your office and see the amazing work happening in place. The lecture itself was also fascinating. It's great to have this kind of peek on all the kind of wide variety of work that you're taking on. Big thanks. And at this point, I'd like to invite a few students to maybe ask a question or even share a challenge that they're working on in their projects right now. As I mentioned, we have groups that are working on circular economy, e-waste, and regenerative assemblies, right? I think Ken Tracy is here from Regenerative Assemblies. And I should mention there's also heritage, adaptive reuse. So we have Dan Whitaker. Dan Whitaker's group is working in this area as well. Great. So I see a first question. Yunqing, do you want to ask a question? Please go ahead.
Hi, I'm Yunqing. So like I want to ask, right? So I know a few projects that you have been working on, and also what you showed just now is kind of like building or like use material that is like previously from the site itself to construct. So for this kind of thing, do you usually already have certain type of material or like product developed already, and then you just take whatever that's on site and kind of like repurpose it into it? Or do you have times that you kind of need to like develop a new material itself on like during the project itself? Yeah.
We do both. Repurposing is the best. This is the highest, like for example, if you want to take down a building, please don't take down a building. You know, so for us, is that repurposing is the best. But normally repurposing is not enough for developers, right?
Mm-hmm.
So ideally, for example, a parking lot, can parking lot become a building? Yes, of course it can be a building. It is it is already holding a lot of weight, right? But why do you want to tear down the, I mean, this all these financial things. So ideally repurposing is the ultimate goal. Yeah, but the problem is, in reality, it's really rare because it's rare, okay? So then the other thing is, when you come down to new building, there is a lot of requirement that needs to be consistent. That's why the upcycling become important. The remaking of that material become very important because you need to hit a certain performance criteria. You have to guarantee it, you know? Okay, so that's the reality.
Then when you kind of like pick up a certain waste and try to develop into a new material, how do you really gauge from like, to what extent should you keep its original appearance or outlook? So say like the Nike project you have done, I know there's some just inside that you're simply compressing the entire shoe. So even though it become a chair form of slabs, you can still see the entire kind of like shoe itself on there. But the materials that we have been seeing nowadays are more like you can see that it's very cool, but then you can't really tell where is it actually originated from, whether it comes from PVT or like PC or any types of material. They come out to similar form that you can't really tell, like, you get what I mean.
Yeah, I know. But I mean, unfortunately, people are not all okay with all collage, right? Yeah. So, well, many of our smaller pieces, we use that what you just mentioned. You want to show where the origin come from. But in reality, you cannot show where the origin come from all the time because people actually don't want to see that. So that is actually totally depends on the curation of the designer. It's not a, by the way, to make a collage is actually a lot harder than to make a uniform thing. Just think about it. Even if you want to make a collage, it's hard to make a collage. You're going to fail. You're going to like do a lot of things to look good, you know, because you're very self-conscious, right? So at the end, the collage is actually very expensive.
Yeah, I see. I think just one last question from me is like, there's actually a lot of like market deemed as like unrecyclable material, like, you know, just talking about plastic, usually they say only PET and like another type can be recycled. But then in your development, there's a lot of materials that actually kind of like get reused back and redeveloped. Then how, like, why is it say that like the usual market don't pick up all those stuff to go through the similar process?
And like I mentioned, legally, who's going to guarantee for that product? Mechanically, it's not even strong enough, right? Okay, and then where are you going to get that material sorted? It's all bunch of mush that mush together. You're not going to take that material. So you got to figure out how to separate them. You got how to buy them cleanly. You got to figure out how to produce them in a consistent way where you can guarantee the structural strength, right? On top of that, you have money issues. Who's going to buy that at that price? It's just very simple.
Okay. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much, Yijing. Excellent questions. Aaron, do you have a question?
Hi. Thanks for the lecture earlier. So I guess my question would be about how do you overcome the hurdle of labor and the resources needed for sorting, cleaning, recycling, and then to then build a specialized process or machinery to produce a system that would otherwise be much cheaper if we look at like conventional methods. How do you like remain competitive on that end in terms of convincing your investors that they just, I mean, it is the sustainable way of approaching this.
Very simple, cheaper.
But in terms of like producing the machineries that is needed at the initial hurdle, how do you overcome that? Because they're all like very specialized in a way.
All our machines are not very specialized. They're all designed for non-specialization, which is very funny. It's like, you know, like most of our machines today are designed to be very specialized. Okay, so for example, like if you say, I want to do an injection machine, it's very specialized. Mm-hmm. The material MI, the flow index, it has to be here. That's just the way how they design. It's very specialized. On the other hand, that's why I always use the analogy of a kitchen equipment. Kitchen equipment is not specialized. Like a pot, right? You can use it on an electric stove. You can also use it on a gas stove, right? Okay. You see, that's the difference, right? Like, I think that is the big difference. So the oven is an oven, right? You can actually melt plastic at your home already today, except when you melt it, your whole house will be toxic, right?
Yeah.
Right? That's the only difference, right? So, and the other question you mentioned about how do you sort the waste? This is very to us, there's a very simple solution. The solution is you need to take the waste as close to where the consumption happens. That's when the waste is the cleanest, the most easily separated. If you are buying certain parts at far end of a stream, it's super chaotic. So the further you move down the thing, the more chaos it gets, not cleaner.
Right? The more contaminated.
Yeah. So you need to try to get to, that's why the National Design Center, that little trash presso machine, is can already take non-targeted waste from blue bin and directly make something beautiful out of it and still hit the building criteria.
But how do you overcome variables such as people not washing their plastics or like having like contaminants when they threw it into their blue bin?
Okay, so for example, you pick up a dirty cup in the, just open a trash can right now. Okay, you know, if you are next to Starbucks, you know it's all coffee. The maximum is just someone's lip, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so all you need to do is dunk it in a water bath and dry it. That's it. You can already process. That's it. That's as simple as that. So again, the closer you are, and that's why the AI helps. The AI is mostly help the machine to document. By the way, all our machine now has a weighing system. Means everything is calculated by weight. So when I take a lid of a Starbucks cup, directly shred it, and it directly goes to a weight, and it goes to a cloud and records that transaction. If you want to go that route, if you make it into a B2C level, if Starbucks implement that, they get a discount for every cap you take back, right? For example, right? Then that's even better, right? But to us, we're not in the consumer business. So we don't invest too much about that, but we invest in our machine to be able to document what we need to do.
Okay, thank you.
Arthur, I promised I would get you out of here by 4 p.m., which is in 2 minutes. Can I ask if you're willing to take one more question?
Of course. No problem, Peter.
Do we have one more question? I see Natalie is waving at me. Would you like to unmute and ask a question, Natalie? Please go ahead.
Hi, Arthur. Thanks for your lecture just now. Can I ask, how hard or what other challenges do you think will be faced if you try to implement this kind of schemes at community level? Because I see you working a lot with the investors and the people who actually have the money to do these kind of things, right? But what if you wanted to initiate a change from ground up?
And Natalie, you could maybe mention that you're working on community centers in Singapore, right? Natalie's interested in recycling community centers. I think that's why she's asking the question.
Yeah,
we do have that. So the whole idea is we joint venture with the local community. Okay, then we provide all the technology, but then you have to come up with a business plan to sell this. Now, right now, actually, no one wants to. The local community hasn't looked at this as a business. Now, most people is looking at this as just take my waste away. You know, they don't look at this as a way to make money out of it. Get it out of my system. Right now, that's what people think, right? But the next level is that get it out of my system. I take it directly from you and then I can make this cup. This cup is made from trash already. So can I sell this cup? Yes, you can. How many cups can you sell? You want to dedicate your shop. So for example, the National Design Center, we ask National Design Center, how about this? We make a shop. Let's make a shop. We bring in 5 molds, 5 different products, right? You can already make the product. Cell phone charger, $25, Singapore dollar. You can already, every cycle, $25. If you want, you can sell it for local community. But the problem is nobody has the confidence that they can run a shop, actually. It's better to ask for donation, right? So that's the difference. We definitely are interested in that. Our goal is that why the institutional investor is important. Institutional investors, they are looking at the long pictures, long-term pictures, government level, right? So for example, Temasek is looking at the long pictures of that investment. So we are using that long view of an investment to subsidize small, to make the machine much, much cheaper. So we do have a scheme, for example, how can we make these simple machines and tooling methods to get it to make it, like, you know, with a rental company, like renting a car. Okay. So we can reduce your overhead tremendously. By the way, we turn a $500,000 set of machines into 60,000. Sorry, this is my cost. Yeah. Okay. Don't tell people, but don't tell the business people I'm selling into, but it become my cost. Yeah. But 60,000 is a car. The whole context is that you want to shrink it down to a piece of automobile you use 4 hours maximum a day. Yeah. So you, the value that's being generated, can you actually get down to a vehicle price? That we have done that already. It's already a vehicle price, right? So right now, can you take a vehicle price? You've got to think about a typical coffee machine at a coffee shop. It's, you know, do you know how much? It's $6,000. It's not cheap, guys. Yeah. Just the coffee machine. Yeah. That set of coffee machine. So can we get that down to even lower? And that become the only biggest reason why this is all not happening as quickly as we want it is because demand. Where's the demand? The demand hasn't shown up. You know, you got to think about it. To have coffee shop at every corner, that's mean the demand, people has been selling coffee. Coffee is also addictive, by the way. Yeah. And the you know, with lots of large companies selling this addictive substance. So how do you make the community want this stuff first? So wanting this stuff, and you also have to make the want addictive. I know it sounds very wrong, but that's what it takes.
Great. So Arthur, thanks so much for taking the time to speak with us today. We really appreciate it. It's really inspiring for me personally, for our students, I'm sure. Thank you also to all our students for your questions, for your participation. I think I've been getting text messages. I've been getting a lot of questions. People want to talk to you more, Arthur. Maybe we can gather these questions up and send them to you. We can touch base with you some other way. I don't want to take more time than what we promised. Can I ask, would you like to share any closing remarks with us for the end of the lecture?
I think I don't have any closing remark, but I just want to summarize that in the end, you got to look at, we cannot do this on a moral level. Okay, it's not a moral imperative for anybody to be involved in this. You got to look at this as good for you first, financially, good for you brain-wise, good for the community you serve, because at the end, how happy you are really depends on who you serve. Yeah. And then you think about the grander pictures of saving the world or something like that, whatever you call that. Yeah. So I think that is a yardstick for myself, at least. And that keep you sane and humble and yeah, a real human being, I think. And a lot of people, especially in the environmental world, they are not human beings, I think. They are not. Especially in the NGO world, I really think they're not human beings. Yeah, they're like in a different world. Yeah, so please, let's be realistic, and then let's just help yourself, help the community, because that will make you happy. Yeah.
Great, Arthur, thanks so much. It's amazing that you're taking the time to share with us. And it's inspirational because we see that you've made it happen, that it's real. So I think that this is a really wonderful thing for our students to see. On behalf of the Architecture and Sustainable Design Department, on behalf of the Master of Architecture program, a huge thank you. I really hope we can stay in touch in the future. And I'm going to wrap up just by sharing again our lecture series and inviting everyone to you know, come and join us in coming months. We'll be having Atelier 10, Nari Vinyawatana, sharing with us on net zero architecture. Liu Tai Kerr, founder and chairman of Morrow, is going to be sharing with us on the Singapore experience of planning and future directions. Ken Yang is going to join us at the end of the term to talk about ecology-based design. So a really great lecture series. We hope to everybody can join us to continue the conversation. So a big thank you to all of our viewers. Please contact us by any means. Check us out on Instagram. We're really happy to continue the conversation on sustainability, resilient, innovative cities. And with this, we will conclude the sustainable design lecture for today. So thank you very much, everyone, and have a nice afternoon. Thank you, Arthur.